It's episode 100 of Soccer Cards United.
Oh,
oh.
Three figures.
Three figures, and we are Centurions.
Here on yourself together,
number one soccer card podcast.
Won't be number one for long with this enthusiasm.
Big episode today.
Listen, there's a lot on the docket. There's a lot happening, and it is number 100.
Yeah.
Could have been an episode of Carnage.
Could have been. We had a close shave, which we'll tell you about.
Close call.
We almost made a patented Soccer Cards United enemy.
Yeah, in a big way.
We almost started a blood feud.
That's one, yeah.
Rival. We avoided it.
We managed to avoid it.
Yeah, conflict was... It was a real Cuban Missile Crisis situation.
Yeah, I did not have a comfortable Saturday evening.
No. No. We did very well to avoid... You were like the diplomat.
I had one offer. Yeah. Does that make sense? I had one offer. And as the negotiations were going on, I was like, no, but this is my offer still.
Mm.
And then subsequently, I think it was a mess.
But we'll get to the details of that story as time allows. But first of all, we have to address something from Thursday.
Okay.
On Postcard United 99.
The last Postcard United.
The last Postcard United. We did say to people that as a little special treat,
If
anyone ordered between the end of...
Thursday show
and the release of this show,
which you're now hearing,
so it's too late now if you're hearing this.
Stop, don't ever buy anything off our site.
Stop
again.
Buying. We said if you buy something off soccercardsunited.com, we will give everyone that buys in that window
something,
a little treat, just to say thanks for the...
So I said if you've been looking at the site, you wanted to pull the trigger on some wax,
now
is a good time to do it because you'll get a little bonus.
And we're in a good mood because it's episode 100.
Episode 100. We're in good spirits. Someone actually just ordered prior to us releasing.
Yeah.
And there was some confusion over our Panini Chronicles. We had 5 boxes coming, but they weren't hobby boxes. They were fat pack boxes.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, I think someone has now ordered off us, Jason, like a mix and match Chronicles.
Yeah.
But we don't actually have the boxes to fulfill that mix and match fully.
Right.
Which is very sad because they actually bought 6 mini boxes, which I thought I would have been able to cover. Can't.
Okay.
So I'm going to fix that when I get home and I see exactly what stock I have. But I think he qualifies for this.
If he wants to keep his order.
If he cancels the order. Maybe he doesn't listen to the show. If he cancels his order, he doesn't qualify.
Right.
It's very diplomatic here. I'm diplomat this week.
So do you want to tell people what we're going to give in the little gift basket? I have it written down here.
Did we pull the thing? Did the thing happen yesterday? I said I had a horrible Saturday. Was it Sunday?
No, it was Saturday.
Okay.
Yeah.
Jesus. Sorry. Back on track. Episode 100.
Episode 100.
We had a few people, not loads, but a very good chunk, and some familiar names hop in and place an order. So I assume these people all listened to the show.
I presume so. I can see no other reason why they would order from soccercardsunited.com.
Oh my God.
So if you ordered, here's a little taste of what you're going to be getting.
A taster.
You're going to get included with your whatever you ordered.
For free.
For free. At no extra cost.
Can I say that's why nothing was shipped out today? Yeah. I wanted to do it all in one shipment, so it's going to all be shipped out Tuesday morning by myself, unless it's Merlin pre-orders, at which point you have to wait for Merlin to arrive. Just clearing that up.
Yeah. So if you ordered, you will get, or you are going, you either will get this week, or you will get eventually if you pre-ordered something.
Drum roll.
You get a UCL sticker set from 2019-20.
I have them here.
From the Haaland year.
Right, the Haaland year, full box, I believe. 20 packs with 10 stickers in a pack, so 200 stickers to try. Haaland, we've opened a few of these. Tends to be one per box.
Yeah, so that's a Haaland rookie sticker.
Hopefully,
in that box. You'll also get a Finest mini box from UEFA Finest that just came out.
This year's Topps UEFA Finest mini box, guaranteed autograph.
Yep.
Okay, that's big.
That's big. So that's an auto. That's a Finest auto.
Topps Finest Auto, Topps Finest mini box if you just wanted to move on the mini box if you don't like Finest, I don't know.
And we're also going to throw in a couple of those aforementioned Chronicles fat packs.
Yeah, I don't know, maybe 2, maybe 3, I'll see. I'll look in. I need to look. I wasn't expecting to get them. Thought I was getting the hobby boxes, so I think they come, right? I think a fat pack comes, Jason, with 3 packs.
Yeah.
5 cards in each pack, and I think it's each of the leagues.
I'm just going to turn on a light, it's very dark.
Yeah, no problem. So yeah, so going to be a sticker box, Haaland year, sticker Champions League box. A Topps Finest mini box, which is probably the pick of the bunch. And then the Fat Pack Chronicles, a few Fat Pack Chronicle packs in with your order. I don't even know like the checklist, Jason, of like Chronicles Fat Pack box versus a hobby box. I don't know Like, are there hits in the fat packs? I have no idea.
No, we don't know.
Maybe there is, maybe there isn't. I'm not sure. Jesus Christ. For the listeners and the YouTube people, if Jason doesn't edit, he dropped the lighting and nearly broke everything.
It's very dark.
Oh, it is. I'm like, whew.
Yeah, you're sweating. And I just turned the lights on. It's going to be even warmer in here. And there's no windows open because of the audio integrity of the program.
Integrity, that's one thing our podcast has.
So
I think that's everything. I don't think we're...
No, I think we're all good. So we can get into the show.
Okay.
Any reflections on episode 100? Or we did most of that last week.
You know, thank you to everyone that has been listening. Thank you to everyone that has purchased on our website and got the amazing Soccer Cards United experience, especially in our FedEx days.
Yep.
And yeah, thanks everyone that ordered between Thursday and today.
Yep.
Hope you're happy with this small gesture. Hope you're happy.
Hope you're happy.
Right, hope you're happy.
Whatever's going on with you, I hope you're happy.
I'd say 100 episodes.
And the people that didn't order, I hope you're happy. Hope you're happy with yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah, really play the big man there, not ordering.
Not ordering.
Yeah, wow. We all respect you so much. 100 episodes, 2 years.
2 years.
2 years. More than 2 years, actually.
More than two years.
It's taken us 25 months to get to 100 episodes.
But bear in mind, we did 2 a week and didn't count them.
Well, yeah, but 100 weeks of episodes.
Okay. So it took us 20... Should I say 25 weeks to do 100 weeks of episodes?
25 months.
Mmm.
So it's 2 years and 1 month.
To be exact. So we missed our 2 year anniversary.
Yeah.
Shows how busy we are.
So, I think we may have said on the show, oh, it's 2 years.
I think we've been saying for a while, it feels like we're doing this
Or we may have been at the National.
Maybe.
Yeah. Actually, I was editing the
footage. Can I say you blend in with the background?
I know, it's terrible. It's
like even the hat.
We could green screen me anywhere into anywhere.
This is terrible.
So,
you're editing what now?
Footage from the National.
Still, the National, the next National is coming up.
I know. And it's going to be a promo reel for the next National. And it's... First of all, I didn't realize you could just film people. I didn't want to be that guy with the camera.
Mm.
So in the day one footage, later on it's grand, but in the day one footage is a lot of footage of people's feet.
Yeah, the floor.
The floor.
Okay.
Just like, and because I realized...
Your confidence wasn't up.
No, I didn't want to be that guy.
And the Panini reps knocked your confidence when you started the game.
Eventually, yeah. So really only probably the last day is full confidence, you know. But anyway, there's a funny clip of a funny visual metaphor, I think, where you're kind of, I'm filming you walking around. And somebody kind of just barges into you.
No.
Yeah. And there's like a little moment, but it was so funny. It was like day when we'd just gotten there. And it was like the part I was watching it being like, yes, that's how it felt.
I did not remember getting barged into.
Yeah, it wasn't a barge. It wasn't a barge. It was like a...
Like what Mbappe did to Neymar or to Messi?
No, I think it was just a mistake. It was you and somebody else walked into each other. But it was just like...
Did I apologize?
Yeah.
I'll agree. Very Irish.
You did. You said, oh, and he... Nothing back.
Nothing.
Yeah. So, there's also, there's some nice cards that we saw.
Oh, we can't wait for all of us to see it eventually.
Wow.
Edit, yeah. Edit.
I
know, I'm joking.
No, it's...
I think our National vlog is going to come out later than everyone else's.
Yeah.
And the quality...
Yeah. No, we're not withholding it because it's getting...
We're not, like, doing a production.
No. It's not, like, in the edit getting, like, fine shit. I want to make sure, like, it's exactly right.
This needs perfect.
No, it's still terrible. I mean, like, I was doing the...
I just want people to build it up, like, you know, our...
No, God, no. It's not going to be like that at all, no. It's, like, the kind of thing we could have basically just uploaded it. It's going to be as good as if we just released all the footage raw day by day.
Mm.
It's
a learning curve.
Yeah. It's a learning curve.
It's a learning curve for the YouTube
subscribers. Yeah, it's a learning curve for us in terms of, like, get the budget up.
Get it up.
What was I going to say?
There was only joking off, yeah, of course.
There was a moment...
I got barged into.
You got barged some into. Cards. Some nice cards.
You're editing.
Oh, yeah. So we're talking before with the Pristine Auctions thing.
Okay.
And we say, yes, we're going to hang around and see what this event is like. And then there's just no footage of the event.
We didn't hang around.
So I've just had to improvise there, but it's interesting.
It must be hard watching back what we experienced.
It's tough, yeah.
Because I'm trying to forget some of it.
It's tough in a couple of ways. It's tough because, first of all, I have to relive being at the National.
Mm.
So having that kind of first-person experience. But then I'm also having the experience of being the editor and going, what the fuck was this cameraman doing? This is all unusable.
Mm.
But you're the pain of having been the cameraman.
You can't fire the cameraman.
And now that I know,
knowing
what I know now, I wish I could go back and refilm it.
I get you.
But I can't because it was a documentary.
And by the time next year comes around, we might have a cameraman.
Exactly. So there's going to be no...
You can sit down the cameraman and go, look what happened last year. Do you want to know what happened to that guy?
Yeah. He was sacked.
He was fired the next day. He doesn't work here anymore. He doesn't work here anymore, let me tell you. So when you're recording, you better do it like this.
Yeah.
Whoa. I'm actually happy that I'm not part of the editing part of this. I'm going to get to see the finished production.
Yeah.
And I'll say, wow, that looks great.
You may be happy or unhappy. You're like, why didn't you ask me?
No, my bar is so low.
There's no expectation. Good.
Great.
Good. Really good.
Episode 100, everyone.
Episode 100. This is episode 100. Can you imagine? 2 years in, you're still having these conversations on air.
Oh my God. How do we get this far?
I don't know. By the grace of our wonderful listeners.
That's true.
So, a second PSG Chrome set sold on eBay.
Okay, so it's two eBay sales, two various eBay sales. Backdoor sales or shady street sales, you know.
Yeah, most of the deals are going down in private.
Yeah, a lot of people are saying, I'm not giving eBay 13%, and some people are saying, I don't have any other channels to get this out.
Yeah. So on 13th of August, there was a $20,000 sale.
Okay.
And then 7 days later, so far one a week, there was a sale on August 20th for $22,500. So that's an increase of just over 10% in 1 week.
Yeah, obviously supply is getting eaten into a little
bit.
The 101 super factor has not been pulled. We have not seen any sales for an Mbappe autograph to date, I don't believe.
No, I don't think so.
We've seen some sticker autos from the PSG set, which are believed to be of 15, of 10, of 5, maybe.
Yeah.
Or of 10, of 5, of 1, something like that. There's not a lot. And they are stickers. So
the PSG Chrome set is trending upwards, and it seems as if last week we were talking on the show about how Neymar and Mbappe and Messi were all feuding at the worst possible time for anyone holding the PSG Chrome set.
Michael Rubin spoke to them.
Yeah, and said, listen, as I'm trying to make money here.
Come on, we're just released the team sets.
Be a team. Yeah, exactly.
And sure enough. And to be honest, I think they experienced, like, they're all.
They got a lot of backlash.
They're all exposed to social media as well. Like, obviously, the manager probably ripped into Mbappe for that one point where he stopped running.
Yeah.
The players, Sergio Ramos intervening. A lot of stuff happened. But I think also when you just go onto social media, all they seen was the circus.
Yeah.
Because when the first goal went in, they made it their business to literally all 10 outfield players were hugging each other.
I saw that.
So that was a way. That was
visual.
They went out there. In fairness, they murdered Leo.
Yeah, Leo were like unwitting victims in the PSG narrative.
It had nothing to do with the two teams on the pitch. Yeah. It was all about PSG saying we need to just shut up people that are saying that we're not a team. We need to show them we are a team, even if they're not, but they are, whatever.
Yeah.
And like that whole thing was like, you have like three of the best attacking players in world football, two of the best attacking wingbacks in world football, and they were all like, we need to score goals.
Yeah, let's just score goals, because ultimately that shuts people up.
And that was it, and that's what they did. I would go as far as to say it's the most enjoyment I got watching a PSG game in a number of years, especially in the Mbappe, Messi, Neymar era.
Right, okay.
The best, just the fluidity was there.
Yeah.
When Mbappe skipped over the ball to let Neymar, like that was, there was just so much, like Messi's goal, the nonchalantness of that finish was crazy. Messi, the way he was passing the ball around was like, I genuinely, and like Neymar just has a chip on his shoulder all year so far.
Yeah.
And I'm watching it and I actually enjoyed watching it. Although it was an absolute shambles on Leo's end.
You enjoy watching it the same way that it's fun to watch the Harlem Globetrotters play an exhibition basketball match. Yeah. It's just pure.
I don't get that reference.
But it's like, they're like, it's not a real game. It's just an exhibition match.
No, but it should have been a real game.
No, but it's not.
No, but it should have been Leo.
It's not a real league.
No, but honestly, but that's the thing. It's been like that for years, though. And there has been, PSG not winning a league title, for example.
True.
And more so, it's like we haven't seen...
But the thing is, isn't it, is that it all comes down to whether or not PSG are feeling it that week.
Yeah. And obviously, with all the backlash, they were feeling it.
They were feeling it. They were going, right, we need to respond.
Hmm.
So, there's no sense of... Whenever PSG don't win something, it's always talk of, well, what went wrong with PSG? It's never, how did the other team stop them? Because the other team can't stop them.
Mm.
So, which is almost more damning PSG, because how are they not winning something more than Ligue 1? How are they not winning Champions League? They're so good.
No, but the Champions League, they're not so good. Or they are, I don't know. But I don't know, just seeing the three of them play in a similar fashion to the way MSN would have played. I don't want to go that far, but like that was the vibe of it. They were in tune with each other.
I'd be interested to see in the Champions League what happens when they play some proper teams.
Not me too. But it's good signs. I love
good signs, especially all because they're all gonna be key figures of the World Cup. Neymar is on fire. He has he's the first player in Europe's top five leagues this season to score 5 league goals, provide 5 assists, and so therefore reach double figures in goal involvements. He has like I think 11 or 12 goal involvements in his first
three games. And I think also PSG just broke a record for the most consecutive, I think, scoring 3+ goals in away games.
Yeah.
Which is crazy. And they had that wrapped up in the first half.
And a similar situation at Bayern, who won 7-1, I think, at Bochum. 6-1, maybe, I don't know. And they won 6-0, I think, against Frankfurt in the opening weekend as well. So, like...
Two powerhouses,
but, like... It's that's the other end for me of like it's funny that both those teams didn't want to be part of the Super League.
Because
it would seem to me that
they need it.
They are the best two examples of the Super League.
Yeah.
Like Premier League teams
have big competition that we just seen.
6 or 7 or 8 of them that can play against each other. But why would Bayern or PSG not want a Super League?
Bayern, I think, is just pure footballing integrity.
How could they say they have footballing integrity when they slam people 6-0, 7-1?
No, but you can have... No, but the way they operate their entire club. Like, they're not killing you on match tickets. They're not spending huge money. They're actually making really... Like, the way they bought this year was crazy good. Brilliant. But that's what they do. They're footballing people at every...
Yeah, but...
That was football. How PSG, I don't know what they're doing.
How do they not look at the league? I don't see where Bayern are satisfied with the Bundesliga, basically.
They also contribute to its... negativity by always buying players from the other Bundesliga teams. So I don't know what's going on there. But they like the dominance. Because they also win the Champions League every now and then. So for them, they're just...
We just get to trot out in the Bundesliga every week, win the Champions League occasionally, and we're grand.
Yeah,
it just doesn't seem...
No, you need competitors in the league.
Yeah.
But like, is it damning to Bayern or is it damning to the likes of Borussia Dortmund who pretend they're a big club, but they just...
Well, yeah, like that's the same. After that comeback they had with Mokoko and Bino Gittens, and then there was a comeback against Dortmund in the last 5 minutes of the game, Werder Bremen.
3 goals.
Such classic Dortmund behaviour. Just bottlers. But after the Bino Gittens and Mokoko thing, apparently two of the Dortmund executives are talking about, we think Bino Gittens is a really special player. You know, we can see him having €100 million price tag one day. And then someone like Karl-Heinz Rummenigge or some Bayern-related person said, this is why Dortmund can't challenge us, because this kid has just made his first big impact on a big game and they're already talking about selling him.
Yeah.
Like, that...
That is Dortmund.
That's it.
Like, that's why I'm so confident with Mokoko, because they're going to market him and, you know, market him. Like,
yeah, they have no interest in keeping him.
They want him to look like the best player ever and then they'll sell him and make loads of money.
Yep. So that's PSG and some other stuff. Good to see them boxes selling one per week and being ripped also at quite a pace.
Yeah. But like, there's obviously this weight on this 101. Like, the box price, I don't think, collapses. People are saying, like, if the 101 gets pulled, the box price is done.
Yeah.
And it's like, there's still Mbappe autos in there, Messi autos, Neymar autos.
There's still all fives.
There's
still,
all 20. Exactly, yeah, that's what I'm saying. So,
Kay Ships on Twitter just replied to that thought exactly and said, if you look at box of national treasures, basketball and NFL... When those big chases were hit, like the Mac Jones Shield 101, the box prices didn't drop. People have way too much money and still love to gamble.
Well, yeah, I agree with that. Like, I think the only way I can see the box price dropping is if we get, like, another few months in, the 101 hasn't been pulled, and we've seen a lot more boxes pulled. So, obviously, your chances of getting the 101 are increasing every time a box is open.
Yeah.
Then the boxes get maybe an inflated price
mm-hmm.
because of that, like, oh, my God, $500,000, whatever card is in one of these boxes.
Yeah.
So it goes from 22,000 maybe to 40,000, for example. Then if the 101 gets hit, it'll come back down. Like, that
Yeah.
It's hard to know.
They'll rise until the 101 is pulled.
And then they'll level out. But they're not going to crash the way people are saying.
Yeah, there's also that Panenka Cards on Twitter as well made a good point earlier. He was saying that as more and more get ripped, the box price is just going to keep going up and up. And I was thinking, like, that'll happen, and then eventually there'll be an equilibrium where the box price is so expensive that people are no longer
ripping it. No longer buying it, maybe?
No like longer buying it. Yeah, exactly. Pace. Yeah. So, like, it's just, like, it gets to that point
where... Supply and demand.
It's supply and demand. It's like a classic...
It's a classic, yeah. It's a classic
economics example.
Yeah, it's a classic example, but it's also interesting because the demand in the macro is so big.
Yeah.
Or prior to the start of the season, say, the demand for an Mbappe auto in the macro is huge.
Mm-hmm.
But in the micro, we are in like a down period of Mbappe.
Yeah.
Right? His prisms are not where they were and blah, blah, blah. So that's interesting as well.
Yeah.
Because the demand isn't necessarily there yet either.
Yeah.
Like in full flow. But obviously the start, like 8 seconds to get that goal. I think he got a hat-trick, didn't he?
Yeah, he did. Somebody asked me the other day, they said like, and is the supply for soccer cards inelastic? And I said, what do you mean? And they said like, does it fluctuate with external factors? And I was like, well, yeah, obviously. And one of, they were talking about like the downturn in the economy and stuff like that. But one of the things that is a factor that makes Mbappe prices elastic is Mbappe's performance.
Mm.
That's part of the hard thing, is like, it's not just like he's set in stone. There's a big demand for Mbappe. Always, like you're saying, like if he doesn't do well, or if he gets injured, or if he, you know, this is the whole Charizard can't do his ACL thing.
And it's actually, that's another interesting. I was looking at Messi, Mbappe, and Neymar playing, and I was like, they're all like equally good.
Yeah.
Like within reason, like Messi is pulling
strings. They're all in the same range.
That's what I'm saying. Messi's pulling strings in a way I've never seen a goal scoring player, you know, craziness. But you're just looking and go, Mbappe's so young.
Mm.
Like that could be, he could be doing that for 10 years.
Yeah.
Could be, like, obviously once he loses his pace, like he's going to be less effective, whatever, but like,
who knows? Yeah, he might be able to learn to do what Messi did.
That's what I'm saying. He has so much time.
Yeah.
That's the thing. I think he's at such a high level, not even like performance or like his stature is at such a high level, mm-hmm. because of how he burst onto the scene. And staying in France, he got to kind of maintain like the amount of goals he was scoring. Like I think the commentators were talking about 200 plus goals and he's 23.
Yeah.
And it's like, he's 23.
I know. He's got, yeah.
It's like
10 or 15 years ahead of him.
Like young Jack Grealish is like 28.
Mm.
It's madness.
So we have, we'll talk about the controversy thing we have over the weekend in a second. But first I want to say that Panini announced that they're doing a National Treasures FIFA Road to the World Cup.
Mm.
And Cardboard Connection, in their description of this product, has a bit that I feel like is almost in reference to us, which is, they say, the selection showcases teams from 27 countries, including Brazil, France, and Germany. This format also allows Panini to highlight national teams and players that did not ultimately qualify for the tournament. Which is a funny way to say,
we're putting Haaland in?
We're putting whoever we want in. Like, yeah. They're like, it helps Panini highlight national teams and players that did not ultimately qualify for the tournament. It's polite for...
Why don't they call it World Cup qualifier? That fascinates me so much.
Because they just don't care.
Now, in fairness, the term road to the World Cup is used.
Is something, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Road to Qatar, road to
Russia. So that is basically like a qualifier, because you've got the European qualifiers. So road to the World Cup is like...
Yeah. Like the Nations League makes no sense, but this makes sense. Yeah. Everyone hates the badge. The badge takes the shine off it, the little road to the...
Yes, it does look terrible. Yes, I can confirm.
No, but like some of them don't have it though, doesn't it? Like that Ronaldo, go back up to that Ronaldo.
It does have it there, yeah.
Oh, God.
So
does the triple have it?
I'll tell you now. So they have a Jeremy Pino with the RC logo. They have a Kevin De Bruyne. They have a Luka Modric, which is Treasured Moments. Treasured Moments is a cool national treasured card where basically it's like a commemorative for a specific moment. It says, Modric leads Croatia to runner-up finish with award-winning effort in 2018, which is cool. The Sergej Milinkovic-Savic for Serbia, auto. Ronaldo, auto. Cristiano Ronaldo, auto. Messi, patch auto. Brand logo. Then there's a Totti, Cannavaro, Inzaghi triple Italy booklet,
which is no logo. No, for me it's like, just throw the logo on the back.
Well, it could be on the back.
No, but that there it probably is, but I'm saying
in all of them.
Now I think the reason it's there, I honestly, like, this is my belief on it,
yeah,
I think they actually want it to look a bit bad, because I think they're going to bring out, like, they're obviously going to bring out sets during the World Cup. Now, are they going to bring out the exact sets? Like, are they going to bring out Mosaic World Cup versus Mosaic Road to the World Cup? Are they going to bring out World Cup National Treasures? Maybe.
Or they might do something similar to it, like World Cup.
Like, they're going to do Eminence. I think that's almost guaranteed now at this stage.
Right.
That's a different level of box. But, like, if they're not going to do, like, it's just, it's, I don't know, it's just a really bad looking logo. But it does, like, that excited me, though, to see that. Like, I love that they're doing so much stuff for the World Cup.
Yeah.
I think the World Cup does deserve to have so many different things going on around it.
Yeah, I mean, part of it is just, if you're going to do a road to the World Cup, like, it's August now. They could have released it earlier in the year. Like,
it's, yeah, if it's 4 years.
It's 4 years between World Cups, and the road to the 2026 World Cup starts in January 2023.
Mm.
You know, like, it's... So that's happened. It's just like, I know you're just doing it to be so you can print double the product, but just like, don't insult us all the time. That's what annoys me. It's like, just be a bit smart about it. Make it look like
you have a plan.
You have a plan. Like, you're not just like, because they're always like winking at us. Like, this allows us to highlight the players that aren't there. Like, why are you laughing? You're the one making money.
Yeah.
I have to buy it.
Like, why not release that product before you know for sure teams aren't going to be there?
If you don't care who's going to be there and who's not going to be there, then just release it before you know who's going to be there.
Mm.
It's just like...
Especially like with national team rosters, you could have like a road to the World Cup that has a lot of players that subsequently don't actually make it.
Yeah.
And that gives you two different... Like, the checklists are totally different as well.
Yeah. Instead of saying, right, take all the best players that did make it and then just throw in...
The best players that didn't.
That didn't.
And just keep making that with different brands.
Yeah. Nah, no good. But it does look good.
Do you think you're going to have Irish players in there, Jason?
No. That's what annoys me.
Yeah, no, that's what I was just...
Yeah, it's like, you can't... Either do it or don't do it.
Hmm.
Don't just be like, oh, well, this person didn't make it, therefore, they still... Haaland didn't make it.
But he's in there.
Yeah. So, you know, we can't leave him out. Because, do you know what that speaks to me? It says, if there was a situation where everyone that they want to made it, they wouldn't bother doing World Cup. It would just be called World Cup.
Yeah.
That's what I don't think. I don't think if it was reversed,
yeah,
they would never say, well, we have to make sure this team is in there.
Yeah.
You know, if South Korea didn't qualify, well, it's a big market. But like,
the Italian triple booklet, we're not at the World Cup, so yeah. You have to get that out now.
Exactly, because they're like, well, we don't have any other way to get it out.
Because when the World Cup comes, Italy are not under that license now, I don't think, if you're not at the tournament.
So, strange. But nothing we haven't seen before.
The World Cup sticker collection was announced, and like the images, people weren't happy with that.
Oh, I haven't seen the images.
They didn't look great. I've seen someone posted on Twitter like the two Mbappe stickers, the 2018 World Cup sticker to the 2022 World Cup sticker back to back or beside each other. His height and his weight were exactly the same over the 4 years.
Oh, so wow.
Someone said like...
That's impressive.
No, but is it impressive or did they just not have new stats? And they said, right.
One thing I don't love is that all of the World Cup products...
Here it is, there, the Mbappe.
This is the Mbappe?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, this doesn't look good at all.
Yeah.
I didn't click on that kind of hoping it wasn't the Mbappe. oh, yeah. No, they look terrible.
No, but like, they're not supposed to. I mean, you see, the 2018 ones just looked really, really nice. Yeah. They're real white background.
Just clean.
Clean.
Do it clean.
This looks a lot of stats on it, but they're not like, they're the World Cup stickers. Like, they're not supposed to be.
No, but that looks like that's over-designed. Do it like everyone loves the old World Cup like
stickers.
Just do it. It's a portrait and that's it. Who cares when Matt Turner was born? Put that on the back if it means so much to you.
Oh my God.
Also, I hate that it's all coloured in the Qatari
colours. In what sense?
That shade of red and like beige is like the Qatari.
Oh, I know that, but that's like the album.
It just annoys me. I don't think like...
But it's the Qatar World Cup.
But I don't think they do that for every World Cup.
Mm.
I don't think they do.
I definitely think they do.
Do they?
They must.
Let me have a look. Say the 2010 Panini stickers. Are they in a South African? No. They're not.
What are you talking about? It's all red and yellow.
That's not the colours of South Africa. Do you know? That's just... No.
Surely it's something.
It's nothing.
do the 2006. This is the kind of stuff that shouldn't be making episode 100. Like at this stage.
No, look, it's blue.
Okay, but is that not like related to the logo that they used or whatever? No.
No, that's just some fucking guys in a tackle or something.
That was
It's a complete sellout. Like it annoys the shit out of me.
You're saying it's part of the whitewashing?
Yes.
Or the sports washing?
It's like, you're subliminally messaging everyone with the Qatari colours that when we see the Qatari colours in other contexts, we don't, you know, go like, oh, Qatar.
Okay. But can we at least do 2018 so as we can, maybe they changed it recently, you know? Because like, in fairness, if I was hosting the World Cup in Ireland, for example, and I was Panini, I'd make... Oh my God.
No.
No, blue and red is definitely Russian.
But
Russia are all there doing the same thing.
Yeah, Russia is doing the same thing.
Maybe 2014.
It's like the only
go back to Brazil. I mean, Brazil is not a great example either, really.
The World Cup.
This is the
stickers.
Anyway, I don't think the stickers look great this year, but I don't really care. I think it kind of ruins the parallels.
No, that's not Brazilian. That's not even...
That's nothing?
That's like some like kind of Samba-y colours, but like it's not... Just like, it doesn't look like a document presented at the UN. You know? Like this, like the Qatar World Cup sticker album could be like could be Qatari anything. National Strategy 2030.
Yeah, no, it looks very, you know, non-colourful, very... Yeah.
So, just look at that, like, what are you doing to me?
That, yeah, that is very Qatar, isn't it?
It's very Qatar. Yeah. It looks like a response to an Amnesty International investigation.
No, it looks like it's leather.
Yeah, like it's bound, yeah.
Nah.
No good.
So you're not filling in the sticker album this year?
Won't be doing that.
Oh my God.
Won't be doing that.
Very, very cheerful person.
Happy. I'm very happy at my work.
I can't believe the World Cup's in November. I know Italy aren't there, so I'm sad, but it's going to be great.
It's going to be fun. Let's face it, it's going to be fun.
It's going to be fun. Let's face it.
Let's face it.
It's going to be brilliant.
Look, nobody wants it to be good. Everyone hopes it fails, but it's going to be good. Right.
Do we know where the next one is?
America.
Oh, sorry. The one after that?
I don't know.
Okay.
Do
we know where the next one is? Have a stroke. We're talking about 2026 World Cup every week.
Comes up all the time. Do you want to talk about the little fiasco that we had with Golden Auctions?
Oh, dear. Okay. Let's get into it.
Did we tell people that at the National we submitted the 101?
Yeah, we've been saying it every single week. It's going live in September and we're very excited about it. And we were chit-chatting every day. And then Saturday, we get a message from Liam from Sports Card Cymru.
Mm-hmm.
I pronounced it right this time.
Really good.
So Liam, whose box of Bowman 2022 is only going up. It's going to the moon, Liam. Yeah. So that was enough for me to forgive you. But this is full forgiveness. He DMs us on Twitter and says, hey, is this your Moukoko that's finishing on Golden Auctions in 10 hours?
I didn't even know that part.
And I said, excuse me?
Yeah.
And I open it and I see our Moukoko. It's 1-1 auto. Like, there's not a lot of them out there. There's three in totality. So I looked at it. I said, that is ours.
Yep.
And I see the time ticking that there's like 9 hours, 55 minutes left on it.
Left on this auction that we had no idea what was going on.
And it had been live for 11 days.
Mm.
I didn't have an email.
No.
I didn't have anything. I knew nothing until Liam told me.
Wow.
And so I was like, oh my God.
What's happening here?
And I, in my head, I just see this timer and I said, right, we're in it. It's happening. I didn't really think of anything else.
9 hours.
I lashed it on Instagram real quick. I lashed it on Twitter. Mm-hmm. I messaged you in a fluster.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, we made a real fun video to announce it.
Yeah, we had a whole PR campaign.
A whole PR campaign ready. And like, we have podcasts with so many soccer card lovers. We have socials. We have the channels to, quote unquote, pump an auction of a soccer card. That was right?
Yes.
And I was just like, suddenly I'm there Saturday trying to, with me tea and me biscuits.
Yeah, trying to kind of do like an impromptu pump session.
And I'm like, no, but this prior to that, I was enjoying my day. I was watching football. And I get this message and I just have this panic.
Mm.
So I reach out, I'm not even going to say names, but I reach out to the person who we co-signed with at Golden.
Yeah.
And I just messaged. It was Saturday as well. So I was like, is anyone working?
Are you working? Yeah.
I don't know. Messaged him on Twitter. Said, hey, what's happening? Basically.
Yeah. Hey, is that our card?
Is that our card? Like, that was set for September.
Yeah.
And like, we set it for September, as we've said on the show a few. We set it for September, but that was like,
not even set in stone.
We put it into Golden. You had to put a random date on it, but we had the ability to postpone that date if we didn't want to sell because we weren't even sure, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we had it set for September. I had a reminder in my phone prior to the September auctions. That way I could, if we decided we wanted to push it, I could send an email and do that, right? And now I see it here. Well, like, I had a lot of bids on it. It wasn't high. It was like 1,100, but like, that's the way auctions are everywhere. At the end, they get serious. And there was so many different bidders. Like, there was a variant of bidders as well. So it actually looked, things were going well, quote unquote. But I was like, this is not the plan. It's like, I said, our card is for sale without our consent and without even notifying us. Like, if Liam hadn't seen it,
it would have just sold, and then
we wouldn't have even known.
Wouldn't have known anything.
We would have just got a message like, hey, there's your money.
Yeah.
And we'd have been like, what? Like, that,
we're sending you 600 euro.
Yeah. And I'd be like, wow, Golden, please. Ken. So we freaked out. I sent an email to Golden. I did everything that I could do.
Yeah.
And then Golden eventually got back to me and said, who did you co-sign with? And I said that. And then I was DMing the person, like, and it was going back and forth. And it was just, I kept getting the info that we can't pull it. It's on the last day.
Yeah.
Like, which is understandable. As a policy, absolutely. Yeah. But that should be a policy. If someone lists it and wants it auctioned and then wants to pull it.
Yeah. It seems like
you kind of have to go away.
It's like, they're saying, oh, we can't do it. And it's like, well, actually you can, because you made a mistake.
Yeah.
You violate. It's not me saying, actually, no, don't.
I actually changed my mind. I don't want to sell it.
You've done it there, and I haven't had any input into that.
And that was my card.
That's my card. So it's, yeah.
You kind of have to pull it. It's not great for, obviously, from an auction house to pull an auction is not good.
No, because it doesn't look good.
It's bad for your brand. Like, it is.
It's bad for your brand.
But also, what's worse for your brand? Pulling it, having made a mistake and admitting we made a mistake, or is just selling someone's card without their consent, especially a card like this, like an irreplaceable card.
Yeah.
Like, whether it sells for 4,000, 1,000, like, it doesn't matter. It's not a Mickey Mantle PSA 10, fine. Yeah. But it's an irreplaceable card.
Yeah.
And it doesn't even matter if it wasn't, like, if it was.
No, it's
no matter what card it is, someone's.
Yeah, if it's a, like, okay, there's a few different things. Like, if we just submitted it to them, we just said, hey, just take this.
Do it.
And we didn't ever talk about when it was to be submitted to auction, then that's fine. Then it's just like, I'm giving this to you. You let me know when you want it. You just go ahead and sell it.
Tell me what
happened. Just wire me the money whenever.
Yeah.
But that wasn't what happened. This was a very specific conversation. Now, I do think part of the confusion may have been that we submitted at the National. I can only imagine the chaos of the paperwork.
No, absolutely.
Post-National. So it's really like, it was one of those things I felt where it was like, if they pull it, okay, it's not great for anyone. Our card may take a hit next time it's at auction.
Yeah, there's like a black label on it almost now. Like, people that were bidding and were enthusiastic about bidding are probably like, I'm not going to.
There's people may say there's something going on with that card. Don't want to get involved.
So not good for us.
Not great for them, certainly. Not great for Golden. Yeah. But it's almost like that's the ideal. Like they said, like, the perfect negotiation is when everyone is equally unhappy.
Mm.
And that's what happened here.
Like we weren't.
We all compromised and said, right, no one's happy if we pull it.
Yeah, I kept trying to debate, like, do we just let it ride? And like, I think it could have been fine had we let it ride. But I was also just like, because we did all the promo stuff at the National, I was excited about that.
Yeah,
it's. I literally said, if it sells for this price now, which is 5,000 less than the other one of one.
Yeah.
And obviously, the last 5 hours of an auction is when it gets hot.
Yeah.
But even so, I literally said to myself, if we make a 5,000 hit, that would suck terribly.
Yeah.
But it's not going to destroy us. But what would. Was like the good vibes of it. Like the.
Yeah, it's because, well, for us, like, we. It's a card that we've been tracking on the show. Like, it's different for us. Like, I think our priorities are different.
We were saying to each other, being like, episode 100 is about to be carnage.
Yeah,
like, had it not been pulled,
well, that we would have
had to come on the show and just and attack, like, Ken Golden and the whole structure,
and that's it, and no one wants that.
No, I said, Jesus, episode 100 is about to be a banger out of nowhere.
Yeah, and we didn't say, you know, we at no point did we say, listen, do you like.
We didn't threaten them. Yeah, no, that never.
Listen, we take you down.
We never said, "Oh, episode 100's around the corner. You better pull that card."
We will bring the.
No, but we said it internally. We're like, "It's gonna be a crazy episode."
Yeah, like, we hope they know.
Like, I was like, "We don't want to have to do this."
Yeah, I don't want to have to do it. But if it goes wrong, then we're gonna have to come on.
Yeah, if your card sells way below comps and you never actually consented to selling it, and they just did it and then told you nothing we can do about that,
and you have a platform,
you're gonna talk about it.
You're gonna talk about it,
which would have been funny. But for me, it was just like. They were sending us a lot of stuff. They didn't want to pull it. Obviously, it's bad policy. They were saying, like, we're going to give it some social media pump on Golden. Like, they weren't going to get Ken out with it, but they were going to, you know, do their best to make sure that we'd be happy with the end result, basically. And, like, my thing was, like, that probably would be the best scenario, realistically.
Yeah.
From a financial point of view, probably. But I was just like, it was like the moral of it. I was like, I never, like, it's been live for 11 days and we haven't even got to talk about it.
Yeah,
this is the first I'm hearing of it. I only heard about it because Liam told me. I checked my emails, it was nothing.
Yeah,
and I was like, just, it doesn't matter what it sells for. It's like,
yeah, so luckily,
what the hell is that? Golden, you know, they got it together,
made it right
on a Saturday, which was like
on a Saturday,
5, 6, 7 hours before it was due to finish before extended bidding or whatever.
That's obviously a busy day for them when the auction's finishing. Oh. So, like, you know, they did well.
Yeah, because I wanted it just to be sent back to us, to be honest. We had a debate about that. I said, do you want to just get it sent? Like, that was such a bad experience, regardless of it being resolved.
Yeah,
I was like, that was terrible. Do you want to just get it? We can just put it on eBay, we can put it on our socials, just sell it that way if we want to.
Mm-hmm.
Have our control back, never let that happen again. But Jason decided, no.
Yeah, I think, like, because we're always giving out about people. So if, and saying, like, you know, people have to make this right, like, you know, something happens to Tops or Panini or something happens across the industry and it's like, here's what you need to do, you need to resolve it, you need to work, you need to listen to people, all that stuff. And then so I think I just wanted to give Golden the opportunity to, you know, repair that relationship. Not that it's damaged, not that we had a great relationship to start with, like, I don't know what I'm talking about, but, like, you know, just they didn't completely fuck us.
They fucked up and then they fixed it.
And in this industry, unfortunately, that's like a gold star. In most industries, you don't just like, it's not like a situation where everybody gets one and they messed up, but they made up for it. It's like, you know, I messed up. It's not, but in this industry, unfortunately, in the state we're in at the moment, a lot of players and a lot of actors within the industry are not even in a position to remedy stuff when it goes wrong. So, you know, whatever. It's going back up to auction.
Yeah, we actually locked it in for September now.
Yeah, so it's in the September Sports Monthly at Golden.
14th of September to the 24th. We'll talk about it closer to the time.
Yeah, and we have a whole PR campaign lined up.
It's going to be fun.
Yeah. I don't think we've ever really pumped something genuine, like in a concerted...
In a focused way.
So, I'm excited.
You're excited to pump?
Yeah.
I tried to get them to give us the buyer's premium
as
a remedy, and they said if it's not 100 grand, there's no conversation.
Yeah. Well, who are they to say it's not 100 grand? It could be $1 million card.
It's the single greatest Mukoko card maybe ever.
It's unbelievable. When he, you know, when he beats Werder Bremen eventually, after 8 years of playing at Dortmund, they finally beat Werder Bremen. Big money. So all's well that ends well. We'll keep you updated on the Mukoko is the basic thing.
Yeah, that could have been a totally different episode, let me tell you.
Yeah, that was like that when we started the episode there, and I kind of came in very low energy. The alternative to that was, well, it's episode 100, and here we fucking go. So luckily, we're not at that stage.
Thankfully.
We talked about, I think that's everything for Hobby HQ.
Okay.
Football week. So we talked about PSG. Messi, Neymar, Mbappe, all friends again.
Yeah, brilliant.
A lot of Instagram posts going on. A lot of like, you know.
A lot of this.
A lot of that, yeah. Hey, but look at us all. We're doing it.
How long does it last, Jason?
Is it genuine?
Is Mbappe happy because he scored three?
Yeah.
What if Neymar scored three and he scored one? How would he feel?
Yeah. What's going to happen next time is a penalty that Mbappe misses, and who's going to take the next one? And we don't know how. This is like a truce or a ceasefire. But I don't think an end...
You don't think this is the end of it?
No.
What happens when they're 2-0 down after the first leg of a Champions League knockout game and they're all not quite at it and they're snapping each other? They implode. I can't wait for the PSG implosion.
Yeah. Like, it's all very well and good. Let's just go out and beat Lille. Okay.
7-something.
Let's go out and beat Lille. Like, that doesn't do much for me.
Now against Bayern in the Champions League.
Yeah. You know...
Two-legged affair, and you're 1-0 down. It's halftime. You're in the Paris you're in the Parc de France. Yeah. And they're all whistling you.
Yeah.
Now what?
Now what are you going to do? Sadio Mane is making a fool of you.
Again.
Again and again. You know, what can you do? Nothing. Then also, I have here on my docket, Ansu Fati returns again. I feel like every 3 months.
That's so mean. Again.
Every 3 months, I see a flood on my Twitter feed. Ansu Fati is back.
It's so sad.
I think he's back a little bit too often for it to matter.
Yeah.
If you keep coming back in and out. Eventually, I have to kind of like... It's like the boy who cried wolf.
No, but it's so sad because every time he comes back, he's so good.
Yeah, but...
But he's so talented.
But it's like when you actually look, his performance across weeks is not great.
Because he's not playing?
He's not playing. So he's coming...
No, I'm not vested in Fati. I mean, I have some... To be fair, I actually have a load of his Liga Esta stickers and I have a Topps Chrome Refractor, but I'm not... I never went deep in because I knew he was a risky business.
And it literally is just that constant debate between... Our camp, which is he's risky, he's an injury prone, he's never gonna have a like long run of games, against people who say, look, he's like amazingly talented.
Mm.
So for anyone who didn't see the game, he's playing against Real Sociedad, and Barca were a bit of a mess for the first half. There was no Busquets and the midfield just wasn't really clicking. And then Fati came on and comes on 63 minutes, assist 3 minutes later on 66. Assist 2 minutes after that on 68, and then a goal on 79 minutes.
Jesus.
They win the game 4-1. So just changed the entire game.
Yeah.
Lewandowski was looking at him like a kid on Christmas.
All the time.
Just, oh my God, this kid's amazing. And he is amazing. And there was times even when he looked like, you know, wearing the number 10 on his back, he looked like Messi. You know, he's that playing that well. But I don't know how long it's going to last. I hope he can make it to the World Cup.
Oh my God, that would be incredible.
That's what I hope.
That'd be so risky though.
Yeah.
What if he's the player that lights up the World Cup?
I know.
A lot of people that have not been following him.
Yep.
we'll go deep in.
You go, oh my God, Ansu Fati. Yeah, I think I remember. Bam. And then you just get burned because I don't think he's going to have
a long career.
A long career.
Still, I hope he has a good season, and I hope he does make it to the World Cup, and I hope we get to see more glimpses of his talent.
So do I.
And hopefully he doesn't get injured again.
Yep. Then there's also a player that is very exciting, and I think is probably doesn't get as much attention as he should because his name is very hard to say. It's Kvara, they call him, right?
They call him Kvara.
Kvara, a Georgian midfielder, attacking midfielder. Who was most recently in Russia with Rubin Kazan, is now at Napoli. And in his first two games for Napoli in Serie A, he has 3 goals and 1 assist. He's a goal contribution every half an hour. He's playing with Victor Osimhen and he's lighting up. He just scored 5 goals in his first game, 4 goals in his second game. He's brilliant. We saw a stat there last season in the Europa League game. He had, like, or in Europa League qualifier, he had like 22 successful dribbles out of 30 attempted. He's a very, very exciting player.
Hmm.
But it made me think. He's no cards, I don't think, yet.
Okay, interesting.
I think he probably have a rookie in this 22-23 Serie A product. But it made me wonder, how much of a drawback do you think a complicated name is for hobby success?
Big.
If you can't look at the card and say the name, it's a big drawback.
No, I think there's a lot of people, a lot of players maybe in basketball as well, that just have adopted nicknames.
Mm.
I think that helps.
Yeah.
If you're good enough, people will know your name though.
Yes, that's true. They'll learn how to say it.
They'll be reminded time and time again. Mm. But it definitely doesn't help. But that's something I was thinking about in soccer recently, Jason, is just that no matter how good you are at, for the most part, no matter how good you are with the knowledge of soccer, it's actually so hard to prospect.
Yes.
Because normally they've arrived by the time their product comes out.
Mm.
The cat is mostly out of the bag. Like, unless you can kind of catch someone who's kind of, he has his rookies and he's meandering and you're going to catch him.
Yep.
Darwin Nunez, maybe a good example. Yep. Luis Diaz, people weren't on them. You said them early.
Yeah.
Haaland kind of did have a long enough time before he really got hot.
Yeah.
But in general, that's the kind of thing, is that everyone knows everyone, and then you back a horse to take it to the next level versus you pick up a youngster and then you're like, I knew it.
And hopefully something happens. Yeah, I know. It's complicated. Like, because, like, this guy would have been a great, Kvara would have been a great example of that, because he was named, you know, when the Guardian do their list of young players every year, he was named on that list of, like, top 50 young players in the world in 2018. He's 21 now, so he would have been a teenager then.
Yeah.
So, and then he went, but he happened to go to leagues. You have to go to Russia where there's no premium product.
Mm-hmm.
So he has no rookie.
There's no stickers aren't in Russia. I don't think so.
There might not be licensed, stickers, but I don't think they're licensed. I'm not sure Panini are in Russia. And certainly not at the moment. I hope. If Panini are like, no problem. We'll keep printing. So it's just like, it's that thing of, like, if you have a name, like Ansu Fati, like, is so
easy
and just, like, rolls off the tongue.
Yeah.
But if you have a slightly more complicated name, it does hurt things. Like Haaland. Like Haaland with the Holland with the A with the little O over it.
Yeah.
If, for me, is a less sale, for him as well, he knows this, a less marketable prospect than 2 A's.
Mm.
Everyone knows that's Haaland.
Yeah, that makes sense.
No, because if you look at what's that O do?
But it's like your man Silas White, when his name was Silas Wagga. He almost got neglected as a rookie in that year's Bundesliga Chrome just because.
People's natural instinct is to, no, quite rightly, no one wants to just mangle a name. So your natural instinct is to go, I just won't ignore it. Like, I have that, you know, like when you're reading, like, something, and I read it out to myself in my head.
Mm.
But sometimes I just skip a word because I'm just going to go, oh.
I'm not going to.
And then I just remember it as, instead of remembering the sound, I just remember it as, like, that pile of letters. Mm. Like, this guy, like, Kvara, like, I know who that is.
Yeah.
But I have no, you know, it's just strange. No, I get you. Yeah. So hopefully he continues to light up Serie A, but not so much that they beat Milan to the title.
Stop. Don't upset me.
I won't upset. I'll try not to upset you. Did we talk about Leeds and Chelsea?
No, we didn't.
Leeds beat Chelsea 3-0.
It was a great game.
Yeah, goals from Brendan Aaronson, Rodrigo, and Jack Harrison.
Oh my God, there was a moment at the end of the game. Jack Harrison got man of the match, person of the match, whatever.
Yeah.
Right? And the reporter was was interviewing him and Brendan Aaronson. Did you see this?
No.
Oh, jeez.
Was it good?
It was like, it was just a normal interview, but just seeing Jack Harrison, who's just absolute Englishman.
Yeah.
And then Brendan Aaronson, who is this absolute American.
Yeah.
I just felt like I was looking at the hobby.
Right.
Do you know, I've had seen these conversations and interactions have happened before.
Yes.
I see Jack Harrison kind of raising his eyebrow to the American twang and the accent.
Yeah.
I see Brendan Aaronson trying to kind of not be a bit...
Yeah.
I was brilliant. I can't even describe it. There was banter back and forth, but it was offbeat banter because they're not quite synced. Oh, I loved it.
It was two cultures separated by common language kind of thing.
I loved it. I loved it. It was so funny.
Jesse Marsh on the touchline just going absolutely mental.
That was funny. When Harrison won, I think he kind of feels almost a chip on his shoulder for bringing Harrison in because
you brought
him because he's American, you're American,
and Adams as well.
Yeah. So for him to put in a good performance, he's kind of like vindicated. He's vindicated
completely.
Exactly. That was so funny.
I saw with Brendan Aaronson scoring. Aaronson is from Medford, New Jersey. New Jersey became the highest scoring state in Premier League history.
Is that because Pulisic is a...
I think so. Maybe not the highest scoring, but like has the most goal scorers.
Most, yeah. Highest represented.
Yes. So it's like...
There's 24 total American Premier League goal scorers.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure, is Brad Fiedel one of them?
He must have scored a goal at some point.
Was he not the one who scored from his...
Oh, yeah.
Was that?
Was somebody bald?
It was, wasn't it? Investigate.
Very, very interesting to see Leeds doing well. And it'd be funny to, like, the American way of being compared to the Yorkshire way of being, like, it's just so good. I can't wait till all the American reporters turn up in Yorkshire and, you know, they're just going like, can I have coffee? And they're like, we've got Builder's Brew. You can have a cup of tea if you want. But yeah, great to see. Great to see. Adam's card said, can I hear a let's go?
I was right. Friedel has scored.
It was Friedel.
Yeah, but it wasn't that specific goal. It might have been. He scored an 89th minute equaliser for Blackburn against Carlton.
Right. There you go.
And Charlton got a 90 minute winner. So... they lost the game, but Bradfield, that's a good what do you call it, quiz question.
Good quiz question.
Oh, maybe Tim Howard scored from his goal.
That's what I do. Somebody bald.
No, I know someone bald. Someone, but that's it. Two goalkeepers, two American goalkeepers that scored. That's funny. Tim Howard.
I can't find someone.
Might have been screaming listening to this going, it was Tim Howard.
Can't find that stamp, but basically it's like New Jersey. Then I think
Tim Howard scored from 100 yards. I knew it. An American goalkeeper scoring. So two of them, Brad Friedel and Tim Howard, are two of the 24 Americans that have scored in the Premier League.
Very good.
Fun facts.
It's New Jersey, then I think maybe it's Illinois, and then like someone has five, someone has three, someone has two, and then like 20 states have one or something. So that's interesting. The Americans are only going to grow.
We're going to have all 50 states represented.
An Alaskan goal scorer.
Maybe not. Listen, maybe that's a stretch.
Yeah, because it's hard to, you know, try to put a pitch down in Alaska. I think is it all snow or is it green parts? Who knows?
Oh my goodness.
Quick question: Casemiro to Man United.
The breakup. There's two things I'll say. Three things. Okay. The breakup of that trio in midfield of the Modric, Kroos, Casemiro is a tragedy for football.
Yeah.
But it's also, that's my one thing. So that made me very sad.
Yeah.
Two, Real Madrid are the absolute masters of continuing to replenish their squad. It's like, oh, who's going to play there now? It's, oh, well, we might use Tchouaméni or we might use Camavinga or we might have Fede Valverde tuck it in. Like,
when Tchouaméni was bought for 100 million, people are going, 100 million for him. But then he just earned 60 million back with Casemiro.
And you're set for the next decade.
So
just, and like people keep showing like the 2018 Champions League winning squad. I mean, there's only four of them left. And I'm like, yeah, look how they've replaced everyone else.
Yes.
It's incredible.
Yeah.
So that's mad. And then third thing that I'll say is that I don't think it's going to work at Man United. And I think everyone's just going to disrespect Casemiro a lot, saying he's a donkey and he's no good and da da da. But it's like, he's not in a midfield with Toni Kroos and Luka Modric.
Yeah.
So I'm interested to see it though. It is obviously at the same time. One, I don't think it's going to work because United's such a mess. But then two, it's like, you know, I'd have to bring in players like that to not be a mess. So
I know.
But yeah, I'm not optimistic.
Somebody on Twitter had a very good phrase, which was Casemiro is one of those signings that assures the floor of your team but doesn't necessarily raise its ceiling. And I think that's right. It's like he can stop the bleeding. Like he can, like, you can only ever be so bad with Casemiro as a defensive midfielder. Like he will provide you with a level of protection, but then in terms of going beyond that, he's not gonna, like,
yeah, but if you have a player that steadies the ship, then
you can build around
parts of the ship can actually perform.
That's exactly it. He's like the foundation.
Yeah, and we also always, in fairness, back to our old age theory,
yeah,
if you want to win anything in football,
yeah,
you need a Brazilian defensive midfielder.
You do.
So
it's just science. What was I going to say as well? I do think, I said this to the off air, I do think he's going to get a lot of yellow cards. You hear a lot of stuff about Casemiro's cloak of invisibility and all that. And the only time that doesn't work is in the Champions League.
Yeah.
Or when he's playing for Brazil. So when he's not playing for Real Madrid in Spain, he tends to get yellow cards. So I think he's going to have to take a little moment to adjust to English refereeing, because they're not going to necessarily like some of the stuff he does. It's also a very funny picture from Brazil duty of him kicking Fred in the face with the ball in the middle of a match. They both go for the same ball.
There's a stat of him and Fred playing together in the Brazilian midfield, and they're like, they do very well.
Yeah,
but what does that even mean?
Someone was saying the biggest winner of this transfer is going to be Chiche, the Brazil coach, because he gets his midfield partnership
for playing the World Cup, playing
3 months in advance.
But do you think that'll be the Brazilian midfield partnership? I think it should be.
I think it's the one he likes, yeah.
Fair.
I don't know.
They don't have too many options. Paquetá, but he's more attacking. They have Fabinho, but...
Yeah, I think he probably does work quite well as a double pivot, because Fred's all right if you let him wander off a little bit.
Yeah, if you let him run around. No, it's like one player around is able to beat a couple of men and run around, yeah, and the other player is solid and covers him.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it could work. The big loser, McTominay. Till he's playing.
The big loser, yeah. Scott,
till he's playing and you're seeing Casemiro on the bench for no reason.
Yeah, exactly.
It's going to be great.
So they have obviously not able to cover the Liverpool United
Monday night
match.
Football. We're recording this prior to that, and we both cannot wait to watch it.
Yeah, that should be good fun. What was I going to say? No, that's it. I don't have anything else to say.
The Man City Newcastle game was crazy. It was brilliant. Great to watch.
Like, Alan scored again.
Alan scored again. Could have got two or three.
Yeah.
Brilliant. I loved watching that game.
Phil Foden shot instead of...
Phil Foden needs to get himself together, because Haaland is there to score goals.
Yeah.
But like, he missed the one-on-one. Kevin De Bruyne is incredible still.
Yeah, amazing. Just amazing.
Like, I think they're going to be fun in the Champions League, because in the Champions League, they're going to have more space.
Yeah.
That's what's going to happen. Like, Kevin De Bruyne, like, he didn't get the ball that much against Newcastle, but whenever he got it, he was deadly.
Yeah.
And I think we're going to see in the Champions League, Kevin De Bruyne slipping the ball through, Haaland strengthened, throwing people off him, and just getting goals. I think Man City, PSG, Bayern, they're all showing a lot early doors.
Yeah, so
keep an eye.
We'll all have a good laugh when Real Madrid win the Champions League.
No,
we'll all cry into our soup. Well,
not again.
Not again. I know.
It's one thing with Kevin De Bruyne. September, the Champions League kicks off. Yeah. Rangers have a big game this Wednesday. Sorry, I'm just rambling. I'm just shouting
out random things.
Footballing fags.
I was gonna say Kevin De Bruyne. What impresses me, right, is like, it's not just his, obviously, like, some of the stuff, like, he played that cross with the outside of his foot. He's obviously been working on his outside of the right boot technique, because he scored a goal in the first game or the second game with that technique, and now he did an amazing pass with it across the goal. But it's like, what I don't understand is, you've got Kevin De Bruyne and you have Phil Foden, Haaland and Bernardo Silva all buzzing around, right? And Gundogan making runs all over the place as well. I don't understand how Kevin De Bruyne can keep track of where everyone is, where everyone's going, and what he needs to do. It's like, he's like a robot or something. It's crazy. No,
the pass he played to Bernardo Silva was one of the craziest passes.
Like, how do you, like...
And the one to Haaland when he went through one-on-one was... Yeah. The weight of it was just...
I do think Newcastle messed up. I think they got themselves in a really good position and to be honest, got a little bit overexcited.
Yeah, 3-1 up.
Yeah, and, you know, free, like, free it's... Kick. It requires... Eddie Howe, obviously, it's classic Eddie Howe performance. Yeah. You get so excited, you do so well.
You want to keep going.
You want to go, oh, come on, lads. Oh,
keep scoring.
It's like PE teacher energy, you know? Like, because he doesn't want to just say, right.
Done.
Finished. Whereas it should be finished.
Yeah. No, he doesn't have that in him. That's he doesn't have that in him.
No.
He's attacking, exciting football. He does not have the dark arts.
And the problem is, if...
if you're against City...
how do you, like, to get yourself into that position... it's almost like a...
no, but yeah, he'd have to compromise how the team plays.
Exactly. You're damned if you do, damned if you don't.
He literally just... his philosophy is attacking free-flowing football, and he doesn't have the plan B in him. Because if you instill the plan B, players are always going to be a halfway house. They're going to do neither.
Exactly. That's the...
But that's why it's so exciting watching Bournemouth back in the day and now Newcastle.
Yeah.
And, like, Newcastle, at least now he has, like, a wage. Like, he's able to buy players that are really good.
Yeah.
He's still rocking around with Callum Wilson and Matt Ritchie, but that's just the old guard. But, like, if he stays as a manager there, he could actually build a bit of a...
yeah, no, he's done really well.
A dynasty there, yeah.
Joe Linton looks great as a midfielder.
No, it's
bad. And, speaking of Brazilian midfielders, he put a good tackle in on Haaland towards the end. Took him down. I was like, there's a Brazilian for you.
Listen. And then the Bruno fella.
Yeah, Guimarães. Oh, he actually played in the Brazilian midfield.
Yeah.
So could Joe Linton. Never mind Casemiro and Fred. They're out.
They're both. I think neither of them. There's my prediction. Neither of them are going to the World Cup, because how can Casemiro go to the World Cup as the starting midfielder after 3 months at Man United being shocking and getting battered?
Ah, he's Casemiro.
No, I know, but.
You put him in. You put him in.
There'll be controversy.
You have to.
You're going to have to stick him in there.
Right, we're back on Thursday for episode 101.
Boom.
Of Soccer United. And that's it.
That's it. Look at that. Boom.